It all began in 2009 when Rajiv ji directed a play for a visiting Smithsonian delegation called as the Taj Mahal Agra Bazaar Revisited. By the end of the program, it was realized that a more comprehensive program must be developed to explore the possibilities of positioning the creative and cultural industries of South Asia at the global level. We first received the delegates in Bombay, where we took them through the newly developed Bombay Airport, which has been recognized as one of the largest public art programs in the world. Then we took them to Ahmedabad, where we explored the power of creativity at the grassroots level, showcasing to them SEWA, Self-Employed Women's Association's actions and how they have empowered the women into becoming not only independent but also the decision makers of their future. We then moved on to Delhi for the consultations.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. In the words of Jalaluddin Rumi, you think because you understand one. You must also understand two, because one and one make two. But you must also understand and. Welcome to the very first consultation for the Seishin journey and the opening of the Lotus Bazaar that has been made possible by the Asian Heritage Foundations, GEO, Self-Employed Women's Association in collaboration with the World Bank, the UNDP, Ministry of Tourism, Ministry of Culture, Government of India, and National Skill Development Corporation. It is our honor and privilege to greet you on behalf of Mr. Rajiv Sethi, Chairman and Founder of the Asian Heritage Foundation. This unique program posits South Asia's creative and cultural industries as collective manifestations in a scheduled trajectory of transdisciplinary events. This journey brings together the Smithsonian Institution, USA, the Self-Employed Women's Association, and the AHF in a unique conversation to realize a cross-cultural collaboration celebrating the common civilizational experiences of India, Pakistan, Afghanistan, Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, Myanmar, Sri Lanka, and Maldives, and soliciting the proactive participation of influential Seishin diaspora in the global areas. There are
We are looking forward to the discussions in the days to come, which will focus the objective of these nine nations involved in this journey towards developing a future of commonality across the subcontinent.
This body, this I, and this Asian journey of the mind, the emotion, and the spirit, the word, the deed, and the sharing of all the arts. How does creativity help the world? How is South Asia putting its best foot forward? How do we see ourselves together, fellow Asians? So when we begin, I may never see its final destination, but the voyage is important. Even in its darkest tunnel, there will be light at the other end. But how do we create this in a way that we can meet each other, present ourselves in the eyes of the world, that really makes them understand what South Asia is about? That is where the strength will lie for this whole region and for the world, I imagine too. Because the region is becoming increasingly important.
I'm not alone in this world. You are bound to me, and I'm also bound to people in my community. And we are linked to each other, each other's neighboring community. Together, we form the world like oceanic circles or the rooting branches of a banyan tree. We are under one sky. We breathe a common air. We draw water from a common ground. We eat the produce of the same earth that sustains you and me. This give and take ties us together in a net of mutuality. This is what we call Anubandh. Let us acknowledge this bond of Anubandh.
The countries of South Asia, the cultures of South Asia have given us so much. Food, music, pharmacopoeia, rich ideals. Remember, it was that guy Columbus who thought he was coming here who ended up going to the Americas, which he called the New World, and really led to the confluence of various cultures and nations and what we look at as the modern world today. The culture of South Asia is not only something that's abstract, that lives in architecture and craftsmanship and artistry, but it lives in people. I think the Smithsonian, other institutions are happy to be part of this beginning. We look forward to be a partner, and if we can encourage people, people of goodwill, artists, scholars, advocates, to join together.
It's not the high-rise buildings of any nation which recognizes you, never this all. It's a rich heritage. It's a type of people who are living there. It's their artisan work. It's their culture. It's their values. It's the traditions which makes them important and fall in the line of their identification. We are being recognized by that. And when I asked the Prime Minister that a doctor treating doctor with a knife in his hand and giving the way of culture, tourism, and civil aviation, he said, what is our strength? If I don't talk of even India, if I talk of the complete session zone, our strength is maybe we don't talk of the billion and trillion dollar of the foreign reserves we have. But what we talk, that rich heritage and culture.
Yeah.
identity is something to be possessed? Is its essence in the character of a community or its people? Or is it something more complex, fluid, and changing? Is it a choice that we make? And what are the choices that we have?
We can no longer ignore that intrinsic to our being is a connect with nature and all that stems from it. So why do we unthinkingly embrace all that is imposed on us and sometimes proudly wear it on our sleeves?
Today, for the sacred geography to be real, you can't tell the Punjab textbook board in Pakistan cannot tell its pupils that Pakistan was founded in 712 with the invasion of Muhammad bin Qasim. Of course, you can augment it by the government of Zia-ul-Haq putting a ban on all PhD theses in history which go before 712. But that does not eliminate the scars of what we are facing today in our South Asian reality. We need to reconstitute this legacy, but as a dynamic legacy. The sacred geographies are important, but they cannot exist with the kind of profane bilateral and multilateral relations that we are encountering. I don't see a light at the end of the tunnel, as Rajiv speaks of, because like the ambassador to the court of St. James, and I said the same to Zia-ul-Haq when he said there's a light at the end of this tunnel, I said publicly to him, his quotation was, the light at the end of the tunnel may be a railway engine coming from the opposite direction. Thank you.
What we see outside in the Lotus Bazaar, the hope for the survival of crafts, for sustainability, both at an economic and an ecological level. Economic sustainability in the use of economics in the modern sense of financial, but also in the ancient Greek sense of social familial.
So we're exploring the possibility of an exhibition that would look at the connections culturally across South Asia. The nine countries share such a rich history, and there are so many specific traditions that cross boundaries that it's an interesting opportunity to highlight those connections in a moment and a place where people are more focused on difference than on similarities.
There are so many artisans and craftsmen left in the world today that it would be tragic. It's already tragic. So many have been lost. Intervention can't be quick enough, but it will be take time to develop it on a global level. And it will take funding. And meetings such as this are to get at the basis of that. How do we create the interest? How do we create the money so that we can move this whole effort forward in a meaningful way?
Yesterday we had musicians from Jaisalmer, we had musicians from Bengal, we had musicians from Pakistan, we had Madan Gopal Singh, who was representing the East Punjabi tradition, you know, and we all sort of connected through our different musical traditions. We found common ground very easily, very quickly. And the audience, which was also diverse and comprised of people from different parts of the region, responded by clapping and dancing and connecting with it. So I feel that, you know, music is the one thing that really gives me hope for a shared, not only a shared South Asian future, but also a shared South Asian past. You know, it's proof of our shared past. It's proof of the fact that we are more flexible, more ready to appreciate one another, more ready to feel one another's vibes than we are willing to acknowledge often. Try as furiously and fiercely as possible to explain to the world at large, not just these nine countries, definitely these nine countries, but the entire world at large, that what has been an alternative agenda till now should become a mainstream agenda.
The history of this region is a long one, and I think that so much of our recent time and energies have been spent looking at a very small fraction of that history. This project, I think, will open up our view and make that landscape a lot more vibrant, and really it has the potential to address really difficult questions that are happening on the ground. Livelihood, you know, cultural sustainability, transmission, all of those things are really difficult, you know, environmental degradation. These are tough, tough questions, and I think that culture can't answer all of them, but it certainly has a role to play. And, you know, the wonderful thing about this project is that it is gathering thoughtful people with good minds and good hearts, and diverse backgrounds from throughout the region to come together and work together to answer these questions. I think that that's incredibly important.
There is a profound connection between poverty and culture. As a region, we are poor. We have 40% of the world's poorest. And yet, in terms of its skills, in terms of its talent in every village, we are probably the richest. We have so much to learn from each other. In a knowledge economy where creation of content is wealth, we really have to look at this whole aspect of creativity, of culture.
Even in physics, we know things can't be separated. In physics, we know nothing is not changing. The particle becomes a wave, and the potential is what counts, not a static, determinate entity. And unless we manage to realize that these artificial lines that were drawn through the culture of separation that divide us, and we treat them as unchanging, we will continue to divide ourselves. And when we realize they were part of one period of historical error, and we need to do other things to transcend these divisions and borders, and the cultural unity is that transcending, Then we create the South Asian identity. Then the SASEAN journey is complete.
Culture and arts of South Asia are one of the origins of civilization and the whole planet. So going back at least to Indus Basin, you know, it's very important to understand the roots of those traditions because they've had an impact on the world.
I've been South Asian for 8,000 to 9,000 years. So unless all of us define our reality in terms of our cultural identities, in terms of the larger community we belong to, one doesn't negate the second. To be South Asian and Muslim is not inconsistent. To be Muslim and Pakistani is not inconsistent. But one cannot forget one's South Asian identity.
Our own culture, traditional culture, can be lost. If we lose our culture, our nation can be also lost. That's why it is very important to, but not only Myanmar, like the South Asian or are the same. Everywhere, our traditional culture is dying out.
This bazaar showcased some of these very confident cooperatives came from all over India that actually started with Jio a couple of years ago.
We are trying to take our learnings to the new states as well as to our neighboring countries. So we are looking at trying to replicate the Jio model in the region, in the other countries of South Asia. The most important factor is how do we try and include skills at various levels. So we've come up with three brands apart from Jio, which is a very high design focused brand which caters to highly skilled artisans in the country. But we're also coming with two parallel brands, which are Jani, which is for the rural youth, which will cater to artisans with semi-skilled artisans, and we're looking at skilled artisans who will cater to a brand which is called Jani, which will basically look at semi-skilled artisans at the base of the pyramids.
So, you know, we are very fortunate to be part of this Lotus Bazaar. You know, I mean, Lotus Bazaar, I see in all the Asian Heritage Foundation, you know, what they are doing. You know, they are working with artisans and they are trying to promote artisans, you know, by, you know, bringing the products to the market, right? So we are, you know, really happy to be here, because you know we are being able to showcase our products. You know, our products is, you know, products made by the home-based workers of Nepal. So we have been able to showcase their skills.
In my view, if you increase the livelihoods through the arts and crafts, the heritage will never die. The culture will be revived. So that is a very important aspect of the art and craft.
Afghanistan and Turquoise Mountain can be involved. I think our story about the revival of a historic area and the revival of an industry is applicable to all the South Asian nations. And, you know, Kabul used to be a really important stopping off point on the Grand Trunk Road. And I think it would be amazing to bring out that connection with the other cities along the Trunk Road to see how, you know, for instance, this Jali design is a Mughal design that was brought by the Emperor Babur to Delhi when he invaded. And that's seen with a lot of our products. You see the same reverberations of different aesthetics coming across the whole Grand Trunk Road, and it'd be really beautiful to tell that story in Washington.
Thank you.
world we live in is the normative structure. The world of theater is anti-structure. So, Jhumman Miah can go into this space and become Gurupada Chitrakar. Because this is not the normative space. It doesn't follow the structures of everyday usage. He can become anything. This space is neither subjective, nor is it objective. It is extra empirical. As the Natya Shastra says, it's alaukik. It's not laukik. It's extra empirical. So what a wonderful space.
Hindu, Muslim, Jaino, Christian. Hindu, Muslim, Jaino, Christian. Sab dharmer ache protisthan. Bole sobi dharmer ache bidhan. Jane go sobai.
দেশে বলো বিদেশে চলছে জাতির লড়াই.
We haven't broken the language barrier to South Asian togetherness. We still mostly talk in English. When the idea of South Asia catches in Hindi and in Urdu and in Bangla, Sinhala, Tamil, Nepali, that's when we win. That is when we win. And that is what we should go aim for. And when an artisan is working, he's working, he's conversing in Hindi or Urdu. Let them converse and then we're home free.
We have decided and we have discussed various means by which we go to 2018. But then 2018, I think this was agreed upon when we all discussed it. 2018 is only the beginning. This is the prelude. 2018 is the beginning.
You know, as the director of the Smithsonian Folklife Festival, I think my role is twofold. One is to make sure that whatever we bring to the mall is vibrant and it engages the public and it makes them think and it makes them laugh and it may make them cry and it even may make them angry, but they will not leave the mall without feeling something. So that to me is really important, as is that we treat our guests, all of the artists who come, honorably, that we respect them, that we give them the tools that they need to share their stories and to do their work with us. And then I think the third thing that is really important for me to do is to make sure that the festival isn't all that we do. It's a touchstone. I like to think of it as maybe a hub and spoke model. It's just this sort of one moment. It's one beautiful 10 days, but then there are all these other cultural interventions that have to happen. You know, if they're networks or you know, conferences, workshops, trainings, that's going to depend on our partners. But I think that those three things, if I do those things well, I will be proud.
So the trajectory to the Asian journey, its milestones have to be very clearly laid out. And they have to be simultaneous in each country, even as we try to reach out with each other to be able to meet together. There are many, many programs that we have planned, whether they be in the field of animation or the field of fashion or the field of crafts or textiles, but they have to be transdisciplinary.
To wrap up what has been an incredibly rich 3 days discussing the role and the purpose and the impact of the kinds of things you see over here and the kinds of things that are invisible behind those. If we don't stand shoulder to shoulder, if we don't look towards the future as we must, we cannot be South Asian. And if we cannot be South Asian, we will be nothing. We cannot be West Asian, we cannot be Southeast Asian, we cannot be Western. And I don't want to belong to a global community where I have no passport for my own identity. My passport is South Asian.
We all can participate and, you know, really get into the roots of our issues, especially concerning our heritage and our living arts and our living crafts that are under such threat of mechanization.
We need to seek out these related interdependencies with each other, between disciplines, because that is the edge that South Asia has to give to the world.
Diverse.
Connectivity.
Empower.
Peace.